The Society for Culture and Environment extends a warm welcome. You are watching a session on Lines on Stone, Prehistoric Rock Art of India, Erwin Neumeier and Christine Schellberger from the Bhopal Literature and Art Festival, January 2019. Erwin Neumeier has spent much of his life studying rock art in India and many other countries of Asia. In the course of his studies, he has visited all the known rock art regions in the subcontinent, many of which came to life by his explorations. Besides his studies in prehistory, Neumeier has published books on the popular arts of India during the struggle for independence. He lives in Vienna and is a regular visitor to India. Christine is his wife and accompanies him in all his explorations.
Welcome everyone to this wonderful session that we have on the rock art. Bhopal has Madhya Pradesh has a huge concentration of rock art. India per se has a huge concentration of rock art, and Bhopal, it is particularly concentrated around Bhopal. And Erwin, who has been spending a huge amount of time looking at the rock shelters of Bhopal, is a very special person. He has studied each one of them for months on end. And he is such a rock art person that sometimes he has slept in rock shelters. He may have one of the largest collection of rock art, which he photographs himself, processes it himself, and then kind of divides it in stylistically, etc. To my mind, he is one of the most reliable source that we have in terms of rock art, and every word that he says is to be believed. I would like to introduce Christy. Christy has accompanied, she's an art historian and she teaches art in Vienna. And now she's a full-time artist. So she paints and she has installations. And one thing which has inspired her are the devis in India. And she paints huge, big devis. We would have loved to have her paintings displayed this time, but she was a little reluctant. Maybe in future we may be able to have her here. So, since the session is on rock art, the two of them travel together and they have worked together. And these rock art sites, I must say, are one of the toughest sites. They are, the rock shelters are carved out by wind, and they are formed, they are always on the sharp, you know, sharp edges of the hills. So, reaching there is very, very difficult. I have been on some of the sites with Erwin, and I must say they are very, very tough places. With that introduction, I would like Erwin to kind of take over. He has one of the finest slides, and I'm sure you all will enjoy what he has to say. So thank you for accepting the invitation, Erwin, and please enlighten us.
I thank you for this splendid introduction of myself. I'm really surprised now, and I'm really eager to do what I have to say on that subject, is that introduction. Anyway, thank you very much for coming so early. This is a sort of early bird session today. And I have prepared a few slides of the Indian rock painting to show you what you actually need. India is one of these places where rock art is very ample. You have a lot of rock art, and it is very strange because the Indian rock art is very close to cultural centers. That means in other places like, let's say, Africa or Australia. Rock art is sometimes very far off, while here in Bhopal, you are right in the center of one of the most dense rock art region of the world, you can say. I mean, in this district around Bhopal, Raisen, Sehore, Hoshangabad, Vidisha, there will be about 5,000 shelters of rock arts. And right down south of Bhopal, towards Katodia and all these places which are now getting built up. I mean, more or less in a few years, they will be in the center of the city. They have very good rock art. I mean, rock art, you have to imagine in this quality, which we know in Europe of Altamir, all these, you know, famous rock art sites. They are just out there, a few kilometers as the crow flies on the scarp of the wind airs here. So it is really a special place, but this is of course also difficult to maintain these things, because big money is now moving into the extension of the city, and like anywhere else in the world, big money doesn't care for what will happen the next year. So the city is expanding every year by about 1 or 2 kilometers in every direction, and the rocks are destroyed for building materials. That means you will drive over some of the oldest communication of mankind. Within a few years, it will be just the rocks on which you drive your cars, because the rock shelters will be broken and there will be, filling material of all sort of infrastructure. But it will be difficult also for the city of Hochwald to maintain the amount of water which it will need. So the city will move towards the Kolonadi and all this Petra, along the Petra. But all these sites are all the very ancient rock art is situated in these places. So either India as a cultured nation will find a way to protect these things in some way, or it will be lost forever. And there is a very sad thing in India, the rock art study are not very well developed. I mean, there are very few people who do this in a sort of earnest, in a systematic way. Now there will be a lot of people talking about rock art and how great it is and how fine it is, but basically nothing will come out of this. So I as a foreigner can be only a person who is very sorry about the state of the art. And I also cannot do much more than telling you how great and how fine it is. And I know that many of you actually know this situation, and I know a few people here with whom I have been to rock shelters. Maybe in some other places, maybe in the Satpuras, or maybe in Chhattisgarh, or maybe there's nobody here who was with me in Tamil Nadu, or in, let's say, Kerala or some of these places. But anyway, I think sometime there should be a movement which really tries to protect places like Reisen. It's an incredible site, just not even 300 meters away from the road. Or there are other places like Karwai. Painting of incredible qualities are there. There are historic rock paintings which are so important. I mean, they have the importance, the historical importance of Reisen, or the historical importance of Sanchi, of the Sanchi Turana. But nobody really cares, and some brick works are coming up just besides these rock painting sites. So, yes, you are representing here the Civil Society of India, and I think sometime you may also have to start a movement on this, looking after the rock painting. So, I'm not very good in talking, and English is not my language, and I have actually no language. I'm a person of the rocks and of the caves. So I have prepared a little slideshow which gives an idea what there is actually in India, because in India there are tens of thousands of rock shelters and millions, most probably, of rock images which come from very ancient time. We don't know actually from when they come, because they could be as old as 30,000 years, but we don't get really dates of this time. We get dates onwards from the Chalcolithic period, which is the period of, let's say, the Harappan time. So we get the first dates. Will be of the proto-historic period. This is the period when the Indian culture was made. That is maybe the Harappan time, the time of when the first iron was used in India, when I mean, some political condition prevail, which you get then in the, let's say, Mahabharata or in the Ramayana, in the historic time. So I also in my talk I will use the terms Mesolithic, which is the period of the end of the Stone Age, you can say, when people started, or not here, not in this area, but in other parts already went to agriculture, let's say some 10 to 15,000 years ago. So there are many paintings of that period in here, but they will not be so easily visible. They are beyond the historical paintings. So of course, if you go now to Pimbetke, you will be shown paintings, and very few of them are of real Stone Age. Most of them, they will be historic paintings, and they are very beautiful and very interesting and very important enough. But to go deeper, you have to see many of these paintings and then see in some pockets there will be also some of the earlier ones. So, but talking all this without pictures is difficult, so I will show you the pictures. And since we are very few people, you can also immediately ask me questions if you want to know something more about the particular thing, so there will be enough time to... Where's the computer? Can I run it from here? Could you switch it on? These are the Indian, the map of India, of course, and you see these all red points that will be the areas where you find a lot of rock paintings. So easy to recognize north of the Narmada, this is where we are now, around Bhopal, that are the districts of Rais and Sehore and Vidisha and these areas, and in the central Vindhyas, in the area which is Malwa, and then of course, in the northern parts, the rock art in the Himalayas is known from. I mean, in the Himalayas, there are millions of rock paintings. In the Tibetan plateau, but in India, there was not so much research now. And it is along the Indus. And then also, this is where all the. This is more or less to the art of Central Asia, directly. Was the art of Central Asia, but the real ancient rock art comes from this area, from the Vindhyas. This is on account of the condition of the rock, which can. Some rock engravings along the Indus that will be mainly on the trade routes in Ladakh and towards the Karakoram Highway. And these are some of the engravings there. They are mainly on rocks which have this desert part. this high ultraviolet rays in this high situations get this sort of patina, which is easy to engrave, and the rocks are quite flat and shiny. And if you just keep them as a stone, then you get white lines. And here you see some of these figures. They are of this early Iron Age, they are maybe some 3,000 years old. And then you also have stupas which are of course of this period. So that, let's say the 10th century or the 8th, 9th century. And then let us jump into the central region of India, that is the Satpura Mountains, the Mahadeo Hills, near Panchmari, but this photograph is from Pore. You will see this big hill is Baikhanda Pahar, one of the big mountain tops there, slightly more than 1,000 meter high. So in this rock, which you see here, you see a lot of rock paintings are there. And it is not really known why the paintings are there, because the rock paintings which are shown there show a very cultured life. They show kings, they show cattle rides, and of course there will be also some Mesolithic paintings which are very rare and very difficult to see. And there was one English scientist, T.H. Gordon, who is very well known on the origin of Indian culture, which he wrote in 1958, and he devoted a chapter on rock art also. He was one of the first people who gave rock art a real place in the historic studies. But he found that although Indian rock art is not very old, he found that the oldest rock paintings in India will be altogether about 1500 years old only. And so this verdict of D.H. Gordon was totally wrong. But he made a very exacting study of the rock art in the Satpura, that means in the Mahadeo. He was the commander of the small arms, all with the military establishment. So these are some of the paintings which Gordon knew best, and he made a very detailed study on the backgrounds and all that sort of thing. And then we found out that these paintings are not very old, which is true. These paintings are not very old, but they are nonetheless very interesting. You see, as for example, on the left upper side, you see birds having a head in the hand. So head hunting and all that sort of things are there. There's a lot to say to this, but in this area there's a lot of tribal community. In the 19th century we are under big stress from the forest department, and even now there are a lot of tribal villages which they are now looking, of course, this slash and burn cultivation, and but still they keep some of their cultural making this memorial boards, which they place here in the primary under the tree. And then you see this beautiful. Yes, and there's a very detailed, as for example, you can see on the right side, you even see on the bones of the made of bamboo, so it is just an ordinary bow as it is used now in the tribal region. And then, of course, there are a lot of fantastic or mythical stories, like illustrations to the Ramayana and illustrations to the Mahabharata, which is very clearly shown. So these paintings are not very old in the sense they are maybe the 5th, 6th century AD. And most of these paintings are in white, but there is also red sometimes. So another region where rock art very early was recognized by archaeologists was in the Chambal Ravine. But the Chambal was the Gandhi Shagadam was filled in the 1950s. are still visible today, but they are on the water sometimes. So if the water level really rises, even these paintings which you see on the right side, which is a Mesolithic, that means a very old Stone Age painting, is sometimes under water, but I came there in the early 70s. So when the water recedes, you still can see these paintings, but not the young paintings, because they have come in the upper layer, these paintings have vanished. So it is sometimes like this in the rock painting, the water takes away the upper paintings, the historic stuff, and then only the lower stuff, which is the older paintings, remain. Another region where rock paintings in India was discovered are the Kanwar Hills, south of Benares, south of Allahabad. It is a very narrow stretch of scarp of the Vindhyas, the northern Vindhyas, so between the river Jamuna and the river Son, which you can see in the background, it will be the Son Valley. And in this region, there are many rock paintings. And one Archibald Carlyle of the at that time archaeological office in 1868 found rock paintings in this region. And he already said that these rock paintings will be of many different periods. He saw already the cultural difference in the paintings, of the different paintings. In some he showed pictures actually of microlithic technology, that means of late Stone Age technology, and also then people having swords and cross and all this. So there is another site which I want to show the same problem as I already told, which also is in the Vindhyas. The sand mining is very virulent. So all mountains will be broken down, because below there is a very fine sand, a siliceous sand, which is used to feed the Uttar Pradesh gas industry. And now the hills will be destroyed, and on the hills, of course, also the paintings which are up there in the rock shelters. Yes.
Would it be possible to have this full screen on your computer, then we can
no.
see it full screen here?
I cannot do it from here, but
you can't do it at all?
Can you do the full screen?
This is give up PDFs on the computer.
He can't do it?
Okay, sorry.
Just
been
checked.
Okay, never mind. Thank you, just carry on.
Actually, this is here also placed in the pictures. This is the Paidaria Shenda, the other English man. He came from the opium department. He was the head of the opium department in Benares in the 1870s. And he left this inscription. And he was also the first person to write on the rock paintings. So that was John Hopper.
Anyway, we can barely hear you.
Yeah. Yeah. We should all move.
Mics are not working.
Yes, I. Okay, I recognize my.
Yeah, this is working now.
Yes, now it is working. So this is the. So these are some of the shelters in Hazari Park site, and also some paintings of Orissa, and even going down up to Andhra Pradesh. So this is this huge area of this Chota Nagpur district, which is even now a tribal. Many tribes are there, so there are many different cultures. So in this area, we most probably, if we make some deeper research, we will have to see this rock art in connection to the tribal culture of the region. This seems to be now a very backward area in India, but in former time, it was not so, it was a very mineral rich region, which it is still now, but the minerals are there. But it is in the 18th, 19th century and the early 20th century, it's very much exploited by mica, coal, and all this steel extraction of in India. And yes, but there are many of this tribal culture is still alive in this area. And another region where there are many rock paintings is the Southern Deccan. That means the Tungabhadra and Krishna region, you know, these huge sandy plains, and in between there are these granite hills. And in the so you can pass over here from the Vijayanagara region, which is very well known because it has become a World Heritage area, this Vijayanagara ruins, and on the other side Anaconda, and this is actually the region where Sita threw her jewels into the Sierra Benecal forest, and so one can cross the river, the Tungabhadra River, here with this strange looking boat. And under this huge roundish granite box, you will find a lot of engravings and also paintings. And the paintings here as well are of the late Stone Age, but most of the engravings there will be of the Chalcolithic period, and they show mainly cattle. So there must have been a culture which was very much, I mean, related to cattle and cattle breeding. And the first people who worked there were the Alchins, of course, where Raymond Alchin also wrote his famous book, The Cattle Breeders of South India. So he gave a lot of evidence of the cultures which are connected to cattle breeding in the nomadic society and also in the agricultural society of the Southern Deccan. And then further down to the south of the Nilgiri is actually into the hills of Kerala and southern Panara. Here is the Edakallu Hill near the city of Sultan's Battery. And in this very early, already in the 19th century, already in the 1890s, one Buddhist man found the engravings. He was brought there during a hunting expedition to the rock engravings in the Edakallu. This is now the most famous site in South India, rock art site in South India. But of course, there will be others now. There are some 100 other sites in this region. And a site which only has been recently found is near Shimoga in the southern, in the Canada. And there on the confluence of the river Tunga and Bhadra, when this Tunga and Bhadra joins, so become this huge river Tunga Bhadra, there is a natural dam through the river, and in this there are a lot of rock engravings, which you see on the right side. And then also in the same, not so far away in Goa, you will find engravings in the laterite surfaces of the Gujarati River, a small rivulet, which is one of these many rivers which actually go down from the Western Ghats towards the sea. So these are mainly very short rivers which have only a lot of water during the rainy season, but otherwise are just some very small rivulets. And in this laterite surface, sometimes very big animals are engraved. Now they will be found out because most of them, they are overgrown by grasses and some sands. But when this is washed away, then you suddenly this these figures appear. And some of these are very big. Some of them are 15 meters, not in this case, but in some other cases, 15 meter long figures were cut. And some of them are, of course, of Chalcolithic period, but also I suspect that some of them are quite old, older, that means Shlomik. But now we come back to the center of all this rock art. This is now the Windeers in the Malwa region, in the eastern Malwa region. Now this is Bimwetke, as you all know it. But these are photographs of Bimwetke in the rain. So Bimwetke looks a very dry hill, and the forest is very much reduced now. But in the rainy season, you have sheet flooding and all this, as you see here. And you know, this is some of the oldest stones in the world, actually, there. It is from the Gondwani, that means hundreds of millions of years old. And this upper layers of this rock have weathered during these millions and millions of years into these wedge shapes. And this area was always populated. I mean, the earliest evidences are some Acheulean tools, which you find all over Pope Island, all over this region. Millions of Acheulean tools will be laying around, which may be 1 million to 1 lakh years old. And of course, after, let's say, 48,000, which is the oldest, and a new technology came, which is a middle Paleolithic technology. The tools became smaller, and a lot of agate tools were used. And the agate was brought from the Namada gravels and from the gravels of the other rivers. So these are all imports. I mean, they at least had to be brought some 30, 40 kilometers to this area. But now you will find millions and millions of microlithic tools laying around from the late Stone Age. And you know, in 1971 to 78, there were excavations in Bimwetke, which were undertaken by the Deccan College and by the Vikram University of Ujjain. And I had the fortune, as a young person, I came to the places, and I was staying during all these excavation campaigns. And now more than 1 million microlithic tools came only from the excavations. So you can imagine what amount of agate material has been brought from the Namada towards these areas in Malwa. So these are some photographs of that time. That are photos from the early, from the 70s something. And the discoverer of this Bimwetke was one V.S. Vakanka. He is from Ujjain. He was an archaeologist, but basically a self-made man. And he studied then in France and under Abbé Bruy, who is the most famous name in European cave art research. And yes, and since we were, every winter we were together in this Bimwetke, so you can see the way how we work. We make little scaffoldings to see the paintings on the top of the shelter, so we went into these tunnels and all like that. So this is just some sort of romantic thing, as we, Otto as a young man. So. Yes, and then the Vikram unit, the Deccan College excavation, they brought some scientific value to this area. So the excavations were done in a better way, and also in a more in a more concentrated what actually is to be searched for. And it was very interesting that we found in these excavations, we found a lot of ostrich material. You know, ostrich is a bird which is not in India to be found anymore. So it is found only in Africa. Actually, the Indian ostrich was the African ostrich, the East African ostrich. And so a lot of beads and bead material was found. And now we also have a date for the ostrich. It died out around 15,000 years ago from India. We never have found any skeletal material, only the ostrich eggshells. The eggshell is a very tough material. And you can see some of the, in the lower photograph here, you can see how they worked on it. And we also found, of course, the tools, the little borers. I mean, all the material. And this is the people of the Deccan College, there's Ian Mishra, one of the famous prehistorians. He unfortunately died last year. And then there is another famous person, Makan Lal, famous for some other reason. Malti Naga, she was an anthropologist, and like these people. And sadly to say, many of them are already gone. So another, this ostrich was very important, that we thought, well, that will be the only thing which we have now to date actually these rock paintings, because the rock paintings have one very distinct design pattern. This is this design which you see on the left lower side. This is very common in the late, only in the very early rock paintings, that means in the late Stone Age. You find these spiral patterns, which we call intricate designs. And this was also found on some, as for example here on a charred core, but found in Rajasthan. So, but again, it is not dated. It has no absolute date. So this rock painting, you know, the first thing people always ask is how old are they? But we cannot really say, because we don't have any possibility to date it. There is no absolute dates now. It's only we can see the cultural expressions of these paintings, and then we can say this is late Stone Age, but it is before the Chalcolithic. But we don't know really how old it is. And then there is one piece of ostrich eggshell from Patne in Maharashtra, which was also found in the 70s. And it had some engravings on it, but the engravings are so common that you cannot really relate it to this intricate design pattern. So again, we lost one opportunity to at least suggest that these paintings may be as old as this Patna ostrich piece, which is 25,000. The date of this ostrich eggshell piece is 25,000. Of course, then there is the cultural expression of the paintings themselves. They show a very developed hunting culture. And the technology is definitely a microlithic technology, which you can see by the arrows with this fine flint set even to the arrows. So an arrow carrying, let's say, 5 or 6 microliths has to be, the microliths have to be very small. So these small microliths were found in millions in Pimbetka. And and then the Indian rock paintings of that period, of that early period, I mean, these are the earliest rock paintings in India. They are, right from the beginning, they are very narrative. They are very, in very long sequences, and you actually see what the people are doing, like in a cartoon patterns, no? Where people are moving towards one side, people moving towards the center, and this is very important by getting sort of to know the spirit of what these people were expressing. You see, this is a we are here in a literary festival. Now, of course, we cannot expect to get any literature of that period, but we get the sort of comic strips of this period, which we have to see very closely what they actually tell us. So the earliest paintings, they only show a hunting culture. You don't see any domestic animals. And what you see in these paintings also, in this narrative, in long sequence paintings, some of them 2-3 meters, they go around, showing one activity in one linear pattern, and they show a very scientific view of the whole thing, like you see animals shown in X-ray. You see actually what is inside. So that means people, of course they understood what is inside. One expects that if one eats people, animals, that he has to cut them open, and then he knows where all the organs are. But then to express it in this way, And some of the pictures show it so in a, such a way, like in a medical textbook. You know, okay, I don't have it here right now, but later on I will show you some pictures to show all these three chambers of the stomach in a deer and all that sort of thing. So this is from an other very early group of painting from Kufa Masih, which is the, not far from Vidisha, I mean 20 kilometers from Vidisha. And you see the animals are quite shown physically, while the human, the hunters, are reduced to sort of stick figures. And then you see the spears, the microlith set spears, they move towards the hearts and the lungs and the stomach of the animal. Of course, then there are also paintings which are much later. They show domestic animals. So if you have cattle plowing and people working the plow, then you know that you must be in the historic period, or at least in a period where agriculture was established. But agriculture is established in this area since very long, about 5,000 years. And here is also some ceramic from the so-called Malwa ceramic, which is a late Chalcolithic ceramic from the late Harappan period, that means 1500 BC, that means 3,500 year old ceramic. Or even better indications are the depictions of chariots. Now chariots you have only in a very structured society. You have to have chiefs and you have to have kings, and then also you have to have metal weapons. And then you have to do have the animals which pull the chariots. And here it is very interesting because they show axes which are very, very closely shaped like the copper rod axes. Now the copper rods, these are these famous, you know, huge copper weapons which were rather shown as a standard and not so much as a weapon, because for this they would be too heavy. And so it is a sort of kingship or chiefdomship, and they are shown also in these depictions. And most of these chariot depictions come from this area here around Bhopal or from Rajasthan. Now the right one are from this Bundi area along the Chambal. So all regions which were more or less close to this these Harappan cultures in Malwa and also in Rajasthan. So we get a sort of, we get the indication when they were made. They were made around 1800 to 1500 BC. So that means around 3,500 years old. Of course, then there will be later paintings which already show inscriptions, like here inscriptions in Ashok and Brahmi. And in these paintings, you also see the earliest figures of gods, of Indian gods, gods which you now can name still with the same name, like this is Krishna Balaram, and maybe there's an umbrella bearer which you can, maybe has changed to Subhadra or something like this. But here you see the two deities, Krishna and Balaram, in a shelter with an inscription. The inscription is translated in Dambukenam, Karitam. So it's a Thomas inscription. And there's one very interesting thing, like they have, first it seems the central figure will be Krishna, and he all has this diadem, which you even now relate to Krishna. And then they have extended his legs, so he most probably was too small at the beginning, so they had to fix him up in the right size later on. So this is a quite interesting detail. Are we pressed for time?
Yes.
Sorry, I'm... I quickly do you in 2 minutes or so, I go through this. So I wanted to show you coming back for this intricate...
Mike, please.
Yes. some of these intricated patterns on the earliest. These are the earliest rock paintings which you have in India. So what you are seeing now are the oldest paintings in India. So one is very interesting, showing these patterns and showing a sort of map of the ideological map of the late Stone Age ideology, you can say, of the religion of these people who made the earliest paintings, showing the world and then fish all around and then ducklings and then some birds in the air. And then of course the colors, where the colors come from. And then you see some of these intricate patterns and some of the paintings which you see them now, they are only shadows of what they actually were, because most of the pigments have gone. The physical presence of the pigments is not there anymore, because most of them were in white and red, but the white was on cancer and that has been washed away. Microscopic, and so it was washed away. Only the red paint has remained, because it's iron oxide. And then you see depictions of women and depiction of men. So there was a dichotomy, a stylistic dichotomy of man-woman depiction. So while the women are sort of the square figures, the men are sort of stick figures. And the women are shown more physical, and the men, in most cases, will be only stick figures, symbols of. So again, women. Yes, and a very beautiful depiction which has been found only a few years ago in here at Benekal in the Southern Deccan is this on the right side. It shows a woman with X-ray and she has a baby in her tongue. And it's also one of the largest figures altogether, because it's 5 meters long and it's on a huge shelter, on a subterraneous shelter on a ceiling. It shows the baby inside. Yes, and these are male. The male figures have been reduced to a pure symbol of lines. Yes. Yes. So I just go through this. And then you see this narrative sequences. You will find women opening a rato, men and women sitting in a house. Or then this is the whole scenery in these shelters. You see many shelters and all the activities going around, like women sucking their baby and women emptying basket. So this thing come all from the late Stone Age, so they are maybe some of the oldest. They may go up to 25,000 years. Of course, we don't know how really old that is, because they also could be around 40,000 years, but we don't know. The oldest rock paintings which has been now dated comes from Indonesia, which is 35,000 years, and then there are some European rock paintings dated also to the same age. So we really don't know what is the oldest rock painting right now. So men, women, you see this dichotomy of the styles. And there are not many sexual implicit paintings in the Indian rock art. So one expressed it, no sex please, we are Indians, but then there are some sexual implicit scenes, but they are not old, they are historic, maybe they were 800 or 900 BC, and from this Jamuna site, and you see this. And then the oldest figures, of course, they are sometimes, these are these S-shaped figures, and they are very often in green. So the green pigment has not much chance of surviving a long time, but it is still found sometime. And it comes specially from this area. But it will be found also in some other areas, and sometimes it goes with a yellow, a chrome yellow, and chrome yellow, red, white, and green. So, but this is very rare, and only a few of these figures have been found, because, yeah.
Yes. Sorry, I cannot
show you. Go further on.
They'll be there to interact, but we're more than happy to ask a few questions.
Yes,
for
please.
Our audience, we can have.
Suggestion would be you keep showing the slides and have the question.
Okay.
No,
yes.
The time is.
What I'm saying is while you're doing the question.
Yes, okay, you ask
part.
Your question and I will try to answer
the question. Yes, please.
know the ladies, you are the same.
I want to know how you ever thought to get into this beautiful kind of work. How did you, what was your journey? Where did it suddenly come to your mind that this is what I want to do?
Yes, that do not help you now to understand the Indian rock art, but it so, just so happens, you know. I came to India as a young man and then I just picked up this and then I see this. Yeah. We'll talk afterwards.
So my question is very brief, Erwin. Yes. How do you learn that there is a rock shelter or a, you know, a rock painting?
Well, these are spread all over the world.
Yes, I mean I move along these mountains and then I will find them. And some of them were known, when I went there were known, and some I moved along these ridges and then I saw, then I find the rock shelter.
May I make a suggestion? Because it's a very deep subject and there may be several questions here. Just a second, please. So it's a very deep subject. He has studied this for several decades, 50, 60 years, and he has much to talk about. So in case there would be several questions from you all,
and I would suggest that maybe we should have a session in the courtyard at some point. Yes. And please ask him whatever you have
yes.
to ask him.
Yes.
So if we may like to end it here, that doesn't mean that you don't ask him questions.
Because this is our
loss. It's a loss, and he comes with great knowledge. So one would like all of you to take advantage of that. We thank you, Erwin, for your for your grace.
I thank you all for your patience, but you see, if I get on like this, it never will end. So, so we only came to the oldest rock paintings. Now, here we would be in the Chalcolithic period, and it's very interesting because this is when your culture actually comes in. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for watching the session from BLF 2019. Kindly subscribe to our channel for more such videos.